everyone for VPE's Thursday, or Thursday VPE, however you wish. This is our second Thursday, and we'll be continuing throughout mid-October. So if you have an idea of what you want to learn, please just go ahead and email us at teamvpexpo@gmail.com. And what we'll do is we'll take any type of feedback we possibly can. So Shane, I just want to introduce you. He is one of the founding members.
Hey, everybody. This is Shane Sweet. Glad to have you with us today. Many of you probably know Stu from his days at PERC. Stu is kind enough. Stu and I talk quite often, and he's been involved with another project that I work with, and he's spoken to my other group a couple of times. So a few weeks ago, I said, hey, why don't you talk about customer-owned steel? And with that, I'm just going to turn it over to Stu, and he's going to do damage. Go ahead, Stu. Great.
Thanks, Shane. Hi, everybody. Again, Stuart Flatow, former Vice President of Safety and Training, Propane Education Research Council. You know, I started helping out at VPE almost a year ago. It's really grown and doing some great things. I want to compliment Shane on getting this group together. Whenever you can get a bunch of safety professionals talking to each other, it's a good thing, because one issue that you might have, I can guarantee your colleague has, and there really are, to my opinion, no experts in this field. I do this just because I met so many great people in the industry. It's my way of giving back. I don't get any remuneration for it or have any expectations for such. I think what I offer is, because I've been at PERC, to start talking about some of the items that I think will be of interest to you, but also couple that with a companion PERC resource. So here we go. You know, I loved when I was with PERC, I loved getting out in the field and talking to the propane professionals, because you knew so much better what was happening than I did. Now, we know CTAP and all that stuff and hazmat. When I was at Maryland Propane Gas Association, it had to be 10 or 12 years ago, and gentleman Chris Caffarello, I suspect most of you or many of you know, had said, hey, could PERC do something about customer-owned tanks? And, you know, I really did not know what the issue was. Not going to explain what that is. We all know what that is. And I said, yeah, and we put a flyer together, and the response was just tremendous. And so it was another way of me understanding that there are so many issues that you folks need. It doesn't always have to be something that is just such a dire safety consequence. This one has to do with safety, but also a lot of liability and things of that sort. Just for clarification, when I Googled customer-owned tanks, I came up with the picture you see on top, but I also saw a military tank, and, you know, God bless America, people do own their own military tanks, but we are not going to talk about that. We're going to talk about above and underground tanks. These are the two PERC products. They're flyers, and they're also available online. I really encourage you to take a look at them, maybe send them to customers, prospective customers, customers that own their tank, you know, because I want to save a few dollars, and maybe explain to them some of the issues surrounding that. I'm neither pro or con, whether it's a customer-owned tank or not. Obviously, that is a business decision, just here for us to share ideas about that. Now, your customers are clueless. It doesn't mean they're stupid. And you might have heard me say they have no idea about propane. I've had so many calls where somebody already bought the property, only then to realize they had an underground propane tank. And what do? And have no idea, you know, and they talk about, should I buy the tank? And I would, you know, again, preface saying, you know, it's up to you, but here are the pros and cons. So again, they really don't know. And they really don't know the safety responsibilities, which I'll get into in a little bit. I'm going to make this presentation fairly quick. They have no idea. And if you've heard me say in the past, you're the professionals. You really are their propane Superman. You're delivering heat when they need it, comfort, and safety. And you can never take for granted the specialized knowledge that you have. Now, that doesn't mean somebody yells and screams at you, curses at you, that's okay. But you may ask questions and roll your eyes like, these people have no idea. And this material that we put together is a nice way of kind of framing up the information on customer-owned tanks for customers to make a decision. Communicate and educate. We want to talk about safety issues, some liability issues, myths about tanks. We've done a number of focus groups, and you know, folks are they're afraid of their tank. They're afraid of it because they don't know what to do. They don't know how to read the gauge. They don't know whether they should turn something on or not. They think somehow if a bird flies on it, it's going to blow up. And there's a lot of myths about tanks. We understand that. We'll talk about insurance implications that you may want to pass on to your customers, as well as the number one thing, the value proposition. What's the value proposition from owning your own tank? What's the value proposition of leasing a tank from one of you folks? And people could be creative. When we talked about safety and people not knowing. That Prozac, that's really a Prozac salt lick that I have in my backyard. I need that for when my grandkids come over. And then everybody loves a yellow submarine tank. And they're cool, right? I mean, they're really pretty creative. But people don't realize that, you know, possibly on this, they painted over a data plate. Or a data plate was destroyed in the process of it. You don't know any better, you know, and let alone you got to paint it a light color. If you don't know any better, you don't know that, well, I better not mess with the data plate. Okay? Folks may not know that stuff. And there you are helping them. These things are great, right? Nobody likes to look at their tank. You know, these fake rocks, it almost looks like an above ground coffin for a propane tank. But as a matter of fact, I had years ago, a vendor asked me, you want to partner with PERC to sell these things. I said, you know, they look great, but it's a really bad idea. If there's a leak, the vapor is going to gather in that space. First responders aren't going to know where to go. And maybe we can have discussion if you've had some experiences with these. And as scary as it might sound, my wife and I were up in Pennsylvania taking some R&R. We walked around and we saw one of those. And I said, gee, Pam, that's a bad idea. She goes, yeah, because the first responders won't know where to go, right? I'm like, oh my God, I'm in the industry too long. She knew that. They definitely don't know about cathodic protection and the rules governing cathodic protection in terms of minimizing tank corrosion. And so quite often I've heard from customers saying, you know, some guy wants to charge me to do this, I don't know, Catholic protection or something. And normally when you explain things to folks, you know, they really do understand, which I think is pretty great. Okay, let's see. Well, I'm going to stop. I'm going to hold off on that question. We got a question from Mr. Schimmel. Jerry, if it's okay, we're going to hold off on that and we'll take all the questions together. That okay, buddy? Excellent. So you want to talk to folks about, because you want to avoid finger pointing, right? In most or many states, you cannot deliver fuel unless you own the tank. And if you're in a state, you can deliver fuel to own the tank. You know, technically you're under no obligation to make sure it's cathodically protected. Or any number of things. And so, but if something happens, the owner may very well say, it's your fault. You filled it up. You might have filled that tank up 3 years ago and still get finger pointed at and maybe even be put into a situation where you're litigated. Lease the tank, you have a lot more control over it. And in my mind, it's peace of mind for the customer. You can defend lawsuits better. You don't own the tank. Now, we know that from the value proposition, people say, well, I can get propane a few cents cheaper. And to some people, those few cents a gallon cheaper could make the difference between whether or not they're getting their grandkids Christmas presents or not. And, you know, at face value, it makes sense. And if you could explain to someone the value, the added value that they're going to get from XYZ propane company that way exceeds any savings that they are going to have, you know, then, you know, light bulb comes on sometimes. That's all I've got. Could have a little discussion here.
All right, Jerry. So Jerry's question is, it appears a new customer to propane only has one choice these days based upon the steel storage, which is to pay a price per gallon that includes tank insulation, lease, and service. They are then held hostage by that marketer. What do you recommend a new customer today should do so that they have an option to buy?
Well, I think that's a question for the group.
So I was a customer service manager for a propane and fuel oil company, and how we would handle those situations, because we certainly don't want to have like that word hostage, because that's not a great relationship if we have to use those words. So it was very common for us to, based upon the serial number, see what the prorated to buy it out. And typically what it is they hear that number of, you know, whatever it is to buy it. But switching tanks is a very normal transaction for a propane company. So I'm surprised that that would stop someone from switching. What do you think, Stu?
Well, you know, as I said earlier, I don't have a dog in the fight. I think that you lay out the pros to the customer, because the customer is probably going to say something similar as you think, Jerry. Well, I don't want to be held hostage to this company. And so let me know, give me the total cost of ownership of your tank. And how long is my contract for? Does it include service? Does it include installation? Why should I do this? Can you give me some references? Maybe people that used to own their own tank. But that is the reason for these discussions. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if folks don't know that, you know, maybe their homeowners association, their homeowners insurance, doesn't cover owning their own tank because they're liable. So again, it's just a matter of educating customers on what I would think is the total ownership of their tank, plus potential liabilities versus, you know, yeah, it could cost you a few more dollars, but these are the services we provide, and, you know, let the chips fall where they may. I'd be curious if any, I don't know if you want to open the phones and have some discussion on this. There's a lot of people on the phone, so it's obviously a topic of some concern.
In your experience, how many propane companies out there, what percentage of the market actually has written tank agreements? Is it 50%? Is it three quarters?
I don't know. I cannot give you a quantitative number. I do believe anecdotally, the number has increased from customers leasing tanks since 2000 to when I left.
Mm-hmm.
You had more customers own their own tanks, and that more propane marketers, some have told me that's the only business they'll do. And much of the reason, it's a business, you know, they have guaranteed income, they know what they're doing, but it's a big liability issue for them. If they can control the situation, then they can control the safety of their customer, the well-being of their customer, the delivery of the propane, and any liability associated with, even though they delivered to that customer, they don't own the tank.
I bumped into a number of instances over the years where propane companies have lost control over steel that they purchased because they did not have an executed tank agreement with the customer. Right. In most instances, it was a case of where they put the tank in 1990 and somebody sold. They sold the building in 1995, and three owners later, there's very little paper trail. There was no meeting of the minds as far as who owned the steel. And in some instances, the propane company lost control. They lost that asset. The courts ruled against them.
Yeah, I've heard that a number of times where some companies don't know how much steel is out there. And I guess, you know, that Mr. Schimmel is something to be interested in terms of document everything that you have.
One of those customers was an 18,000 gallon above ground in saddles at a commercial building here in the Northeast. I mean, the company had the receipt for the purchase of this tank, which was in 1990. And, you know, 20 years later, they lost it in a court battle because they didn't have their agreements put together.
It's a very unique, the propane industry, very unique in that regard. Any other comments or questions, folks?
Do you want to do a poll to see what customers or what the companies out there, let's see, do you offer lease or buy, lease only, or we deliver to customer-owned tanks? Do you want to send that poll out? So I've just opened that up and we're having people right now. And if it doesn't pop up on your screen, folks, go ahead and look down below. You'll see where it says polls. It should have a little red dot. So just click on it and we'll bring it up for you. So let's see, we're halfway there. We got 50% of the folks already that are already voting. And yeah, we're getting 85%. Of course, people are still doing it. 85% of the companies on board, they deliver to customer-owned tanks. So my question goes is, how do they document it? What programs do they use? You know, are they in the Taurus? Do they use Blue Cow? Do they use ads? How do they track it to make sure that steel does not get lost like you were talking about? If anyone wants to share anything, you can just raise your hand.
I think the answer to your question is the customer service agreements that are initially completed when you bring on a new customer and a new tank installation. Everything should be covered there.
Now, how does the customer know that that's what they're getting into? Because a lot of customers says, I don't read things. Do you have your customer service folks do it? Do you have an installer? How does that transaction make?
Well, I'm not a propane marketer. I'm a vendor, but my understanding is there's a process to bring on a new customer. Any marketer has their own process. It could involve a variety of people, but ultimately, we have a lot of customers that we support who are providing, you know, duty to warn materials along with a customer service agreement and a credit check and all of that stuff. Sometimes it's done on site or prior to installing the tank, but it's a critical piece of the business relationship, show, so it's got to be done very carefully. And obviously, you would expect people to read what they're signing.
Hey, so you're operating this space of dotting I's and crossing T's.
Yep.
I mean, if you had to put a number to it, what percentage of the propane marketers in your markets do not have something that would pass as a tank agreement that is customer specific? You must bump into that.
We bump into it a lot, Shane, and to be honest with you, sometimes documents are provided from legal counsel. Sometimes it's provided from insurance personnel. There are some standard templates out there, but inevitably a very comprehensive customer service agreement is critical to any propane operation. And one of the documents that we have used, and we can now do that electronically, is a tank lease agreement that was reviewed and approved by John Hansen and his firm. So I think anybody that's paying attention is really going to have to make sure legal counsel reviews and approves whatever document that they're using with the customer base.
So Jerry, notwithstanding the agreement, are you aware of marketers that actually go to the extent of filing a UCC statement in the land records?
Not to my knowledge.
It's cumbersome to do so, but and I've seen that, I wouldn't say the majority of the time, but I know a number of marketers that do that.
I have a question for the group before I do another poll. I understand, I wouldn't think companies are not going to deliver, other customers, but to those that own a tank. But I'm curious, how many provide customer-owned tank information, whether it's the perk material or other material, to customers that own their own tanks? Of course, the next one would be, have there ever been any liability issues to that? But if anybody wants to talk about that one.
Can you rephrase that for me while I type it?
Yeah, I'm just curious. How many have provided information similar to, whether it be perk or other, on customer-owned tanks to customers that own their own tanks?
So people are starting to answer. And we have 89% that says yes. I know in the state of Vermont, we had to do it yearly. Do many other states have that? So I live in Vermont, and part of the regulations for CF 111 is that for any type of information or changes or anything like that, it needs to be sent once a year. Do other states have that regulations?
They have it in a couple of different states that I'm aware of.
Does that resolve that issue of people feeling hostage if the states that do have it versus they don't?
It's interesting. I had a conversation with John Jessup from North Carolina last week, and evidently there's a large multi-state marketer that has created a lot of havoc with delivery to customers, and independent marketers are taking advantage of it. And there's issues back and forth, and you have the ability to deliver tank fuel to another customer-owned tank from another company. It's very complicated. And I don't know all the details of it. It's something that's happening right now in a variety of states.
Is North Carolina a container state?
Yes.
So is this over emergency deliveries?
This is regular fuel delivery.
Really?
Huh. Yeah.
The reason I ask is the New York legislation was all about emergency fuel. And of course, New York is not a container law state. And that's a whole nother discussion. So anything else?
You can just raise your hand. But I thought it was interesting when you were mentioning about painting customers' tank and the placard. I don't think customers have any idea about the URL placard that's right there and that you need it.
The data plate. Yeah.
Thank you. The data plate.
No, they don't know that. They don't know that it's not a good idea to put one on fake rock. So, I mean, I wouldn't know. I would think, great, I don't have to look at the thing, you know, but people are creative. You know, fortunately, that type of creativity, the chances of it causing an incident versus some of the other creativity of DIYers, which is much more laden with risk factors. But nonetheless, I mean, I've heard propane professionals, and I know the courts, a lot of times it's like, you should have known better. You're the professional. You should have told your customer that. You know, that becomes almost an unlimited list of things that you should have told your customer about. You know, you should have told your customer not to put your 20 pounder in the oven to try and, you know, kill your husband. Yeah, you should have told the customer not to take a propane torch and try to use it to cook a squirrel with, and you end up burning.
You should have told your customer not to paint his 1,000-gallon above ground black.
Yeah. So, you know, there are just so many things. Again, the chances of something happening are not great, but they do happen. And again, you know, as Jerry alluded to, as everyone here knows, rock solid documentation. And again, I think it's a matter, I mean, obviously all of you or the vast majority have communicated to your customers their responsibility and value proposition of leasing a tank. You know, I mean, you don't want to beat it up, you know, people, I don't want to do it. Well, that's fine. But you do have to protect yourself because, as we know in court, and we don't, of course, don't want it to get hurt, the playing field is not level. And so the more you document, the more you could show somebody that, you know, show that you provided this information. This is what we provide. This is what we don't provide. You know,
what are the resources for the dealers? I think, I believe you mentioned maybe PERC has some help with that. Is there any other where, anywhere else that dealers can go to? So at least there can be documentation that I sent out a mass mailing or an e-blast or something to help them protect themselves.
Well, propane marketers are free anything they want, but I don't know of any. See, the real benefit of having, at least of having PERC do things like that, it's a real uniform statement, you know, which is was developed by the industry subject matter experts. So it's a uniform statement. But, you know, how propane retailers, marketers, professionals, how they go about showing that they provide that information is certainly up to them.
Because there's a lot of challenging things that the propane suppliers have to do. Because, right, they have to make sure they educate their drivers, making sure it's safe with the tank and the marketing. It's a lot. There's a lot. And it's good to know that there are resources out there.
Yeah. If you're not familiar with those flyers, though a large majority of you are, I mean, I'd even, if you have emails to your customers, email them to them with a return receipt, you know, but it's there for you. It's a free download or you could mail them. But for something that I knew, I'll just show you, I knew nothing about this issue really. And quite candidly, I was trying to get funding about it. You know, people are like, what do you want that for? It's not sexy or anything, but it turned out it was one of those non-sexy issues that the industry does grapple with, among, as you said, Mary, among other things.
We ran over just a little bit, but we can just hang out for anybody that wants to get their mic on and at least start, you know, continuing the conversation.
So, Mike, I mean, you deal with expert testimony and stuff and with some of your clients. I mean, this issue of customer-owned steel, I'm guessing you've bumped into this in the courts?
Yeah, quite often it does come up in litigation, who owned the tank. But it still goes back to the gas company filling the tank. The gas company has the ultimate responsibility to educate the consumer and keep the consumer safe. So customer owned.
With customer owned steel, Mike? I mean, if you bumped into cases where, you know, hypothetically the customer, you know, other than filling the fuel, they won't allow people on the property. Have you bumped into that, you know, to inspect equipment? Has that ever come up?
Oh yes, lots of times.
And I was going to say, you're saying that like it happens a lot.
Well, I've interestingly enough, I can make everybody laugh. I had one service tech where the homeowner said, if you come on my property, I'm going to shoot you.
So okay.
You can't make this stuff up.
Yeah. Well, thanks for weighing in here, Mike. Jerry Schimmel, if you can hear me, thanks for participating.
You're welcome.
Stu, MR, you got anything else?
No.
I'll just add for everybody listening, the gas company is always held to the highest standard of care. So
yeah,
just beware.
Well, I just wanted to say thank you again, Shane. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed doing this. And unless you're sick of me, I'd be more than happy to do some more in the future. And wish you all and your families the best. Stay safe and stay sane.
Thanks, Stu. Thanks very much.
Thank you.